Welcome to Good Gift City Church Online, everyone. It's lovely to have you come around again over the airwaves, over the internet, through whatever devices you're on and wherever you are, whatever time zone you're in. It's always such a joy and such a privilege for us to be able to share with you our worship, our ministry, and all that the Lord has entrusted to us. So open your hearts together with us as we prepare ourselves to worship our Lord Jesus, to declare His goodness, and to receive His truth. Let's pray. Father, we thank You once again for bringing us together again. And as we enter into this time of praise and worship and instruction from Your wonderful Word, we ask that Your Holy Spirit would just fill every place that we are in, that right now we will begin to connect with You in our hearts. As we open up our minds, we begin to receive revelation, goodness, encouragement, and strength. So Lord, we thank You that you say according to Your word, when two or three are gathered together in Your name, there You will be in the midst of them. And as we gather, or some may be, yes, maybe alone, but we are not alone in the sense of being by ourselves, because Your Holy Spirit is there and You are present with everyone. And for those of us who are gathered in our families, in our little watch parties, Lord, we just call down your presence and Your power to minister to every single person, that we will come away from this time stronger, clearer, more committed to You and Your cause and Your gospel than ever before. You'll come out of this wiser, hallelujah, braver, and with greater wisdom and understanding of Your ways. In Jesus' name, everybody say, Amen.
Psalms 145, verses 13 to 15. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and Your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all of His words, and kind in all of His works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to You, and You give them their food in due season. You know, if we look in the Old Testament, we see the rebellion and the sinfulness of Israel. And then time and time again, they fall. But our God, who is ever faithful and ever loving, redeems Israel over and over again. It's very clear in the verse that God's goodness and faithfulness is independent of ours. I just want you to remember that nothing we can ever do will ever change that.
Faithfulness. Heavenly
blessing never failed me, and all my tears I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God all my life. Goodness of God. I love your voice. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and darkest nights. You were close like no other. I've known you. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend.
All my life.
That was a great time of worship. I enjoyed that. And I trust you have encountered the Lord in some way as you express yourself through song and lyric. Okay, by the way, there's some construction work going on around us. And if you kind of hear some noises, don't let that distract you, okay? It's not something we can do anything about. Some floors above us, some heavy work is going on. Anyway, here are some announcements. Okay, first and foremost, I want to present my book, God Wants to Heal, as a gift to anyone who would like to read what the Word of God has to say about the ministry of healing. Yeah, God wants to heal, and all you need to do is to scan the barcode, and it will take you to, or the QR code, it will take you to a request page on our website, and then you can apply. It's free, okay, but of course we would like the small donation to cover the cost of production and shipping. And we actually have more than 100 people who have already requested for these books over the last few months as I first launched this kind of a token of appreciation to those of you, and also to spread the word about healing. And if you have received the books, we'll be grateful if you can send us a small donation, as I said, to cover the cost of production and shipping. Okay, then next week we have a dear friend who will be coming back to minister to us again. He is Pastor Eugene Sell. Okay, he's now kind of a consultant leader and spiritual leader in many places, in many important organizations. And we always love to have him with us. He's always got a timely word for the church. And so I want you to invite your friends next week as Pastor Eugene come to speak to us. And then after the service, don't forget we have our Zoom prayer room. So if you have a need, or if some of your friends have a need, invite them to come and join us. The link will be flashed before you, and then you can come in, and we will love to be able to encourage you and pray with you. Thank you. Let's now continue to receive God's word and sing together, "I'm Listening to Prepare Our Hearts."
Suddenly I'm not afraid, 'cause you speak, freedom reigns, there is hope, and every single word you say. So rose wrong, troubles listening. Quiet my heart, I'm listening. Oh, quiet my heart, I'm listening.
I trust you have been blessed by this series of sermons on justice. Professor Teo Lien gave us a comprehensive and insightful overview. My last two sessions dealt with the two big questions on how to respond when bad things happen to good people and when good things happen to bad people. Today, I would like to wind up this important series of sermons and talk about justice, the art of judging. Let's read together from Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 to 6. Okay, open your scriptures, just declare aloud together and fill the environment with the word of God. Are you ready? Let's go. Do not judge others, and you will not be judged, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, "Let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye," when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrite, first get rid of the log in your own eye. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Don't waste what is holy on people who are unholy. Don't throw your pearls to pigs. They will trample the pearls, then turn and attack you. Do you know that the first words of this Bible passage, "Judge not, and you will not be judged," is one of the most quoted texts from the Bible? It's used by all kinds of people. And let me tell you about the kind of people who would use this verse. Okay. First of all, it's people who avoid controversy. And these are folk who think that arguments will spoil relationships. And their temperament is such that they will find it hard to handle any kind of robust discussion. They cannot be objective and tends to take things personally. They will do anything to keep the peace and won't mind sweeping things under the carpet. They may even believe by doing that, they're being loving. The second kind of people who use this scripture are people who cannot handle criticism. This verse becomes a convenient statement to fend off any kind of criticism against them. And their root problem may be pride and unteachability. The third kind of people who use this scripture are people who defend someone they like or admire from criticism. They are kind of loyal folk, right? There are actually many such loyal, unquestioning folk around. They are so enamored by certain personalities that they cannot contemplate any wrong in the object of their admiration. The people they admire could be a famous entertainer, politician, or even pastor. Then the fourth kind of people who will use this scripture are non-Christians. Okay. Non-Christians whose values and lifestyles violate God's word. And these verses are used by them frequently on social media, like by the LGBTQ activists, against Christians or other people who express disapproval of their activities. Why do you judge us? Who are you to judge us? And you're just bigots and homophobic, etc., etc. So, are all these people correct? They are quoting the Bible, right? Well, there's a saying among preachers: a scripture out of context is a pretext. First of all, let us get the definition of the word judge. Okay, the Greek word is krino. krino. Gonna say that? Learn a bit of Greek today, okay? And you can see a whole list of meanings there I've listed for us. Meaning that includes decide, coming to a conclusion. That's a form of judgment, right? Prefer, to accept one thing better than another. Evaluation, yeah, holding a view, having an opinion based on what we believe to be the correctness of something. Then on a more legal side, okay, to make a decision, a legal question of what is right and what is wrong. Then to rule and govern. This is very important, keep that in mind. Then determining guilt or innocence. Yeah, this is of course in a court of law. Then to condemn, yeah, coming to a verdict, so to speak, declaring somebody guilty. And finally, the administration of fairness. This has to do with judgment. So as you can see, this word has a whole range of meanings. And the meaning depends on the context of where the word appears. And as we look at the various meanings, you can understand that God never intends that we should never exercise judgment. In fact, this word, krino, or its other form in the Hebrew, appears 639 times in the Bible. Let's share a few of the verses that talks about this concept of judging. Now let's go first to Genesis chapter 19 and verse 9. Read together. Stand back, they shouted. This fellow came to town as an outsider, and now he's acting like our judge. We treat you far worse than those other men. And they lunged toward Lot to break down the door. Who do you think was the first human judge in history? Well, the scripture there tells us. It's a man by the name of Lot. And who was Lot? Lot was the nephew of Abraham. And in this passage in the Bible, he was in a place called Sodom. And two angels came from God, and Lot provided hospitality for them, and the men of Sodom started gathering around the house, and they wanted Lot to release the two angels who came in the appearance of human beings for them, so that they can rape them. That's where the word sodomize come from, okay? From the place called Sodom. Lot tried to protect them. Now, these men are turning onto Lot. And one of the reasons was that he has been speaking out against the values and the sinful practices of the people in Sodom and Gomorrah. And they hated him for his judgment against them. Then in Deuteronomy chapter 16, verses 18 to 20, God said to the Israelites, appoint judges and officials for yourselves from each of your tribes in all the towns the Lord your God is giving you. They must judge the people fairly. You must never twist justice or show partiality. Never accept a bribe, for bribes blind the eyes of the wise and corrupt the decisions of the godly. Let true justice prevail, so you may live and occupy the land that the Lord your God is giving you. God commanded the children of Israel to appoint judges who are incorruptible, so that they can live, will live and occupy the land. There's a book in the Bible, a whole book in the Bible called Judges. And it's about men and women anointed by God to lead people back to Him and defend Israel against her enemies. The next scripture about judging is very interesting. It's a big one for you and for me. Okay, it's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 to 6. Read this carefully with me. When one of you has a dispute with another believer, how dare you file a lawsuit and ask a secular court to decide the matter instead of taking it to other believers? Don't you realize we believers will judge, that someday we believers will judge the world? And since you're going to judge the world, can't you decide even these little things among yourselves? Don't you realize that we will judge angels? So you should surely be able to resolve ordinary disputes in this life. If you have legal disputes about such matters, why go to outside judges who are not respected by the church. I'm saying this to shame you. Is there anyone in all the church who is wise enough to decide these issues? But instead, one believer shoots another in front, right in front of unbelievers. This may astound some of you. God says we are one day going to judge the world and angels, of course, with the Lord Jesus. And the angels are probably the fallen ones, the demons. But no, this is our destiny. This is huge. So God is never saying that we are not to judge. In fact, to say that I don't judge is already a judgment. It's already an assessment, already a decision. I can be saying I don't care about right or wrong. Or I can be expressing a defensiveness about someone, or even showing that I'm too lazy to work out the rights and wrongs about this issue. Now, it does not mean that to be engaged in judgment, we need to be argumentative. It depends on the importance of the subject, the situation, before we get engaged. But I hope you're beginning to get a picture, to grasp the importance of this issue of justice. And we want to learn the art of judging from today. God says that the church ought to have enough people, wise enough, to resolve all kinds of conflicts between believers. It's a shame when we resort to secular courts to settle our differences. At worst, God says, endure being mistreated or taken advantage of and trust Him for our vindication. He says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 7, even to have lawsuits with one another is a defeat for you. Why not accept the injustice and leave it at that? Why not let yourselves be cheated? So God is in the business of training you and me to rule and judge with Him. So I want to enroll you in this course. I call it the Art of Judging. Okay? There are three levels to this program. Okay? Level one, we must start with judging the self. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 2 to 5, read with me. For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrite! First get rid of the log in your own eye. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Jesus here gave a stark and unmistakable picture of where and how we must begin our lessons on the art of judging. He painted an exaggerated picture of a person with a log of wood in his own eye trying to remove a speck, a tiny speck of sawdust from someone else's eye. Quite a hilarious picture, right? This is a description of a self-righteous and arrogant person who's either indifferent or in complete denial about his own obvious character flaws. Yet, he's quick to point out the comparatively minor errors other people make. I know a person who outwardly looks very respectable. When she first arrived in church, she met up with me with her husband and told me that they are both worth tens of millions of dollars. She was regular in the services and she knows the Bible. But over the years, I saw another side of her. In spite of her wealth, she was calculative and would get into fierce fights with business associates over money. I was even dragged into having to arbitrate over two cases. One of which, she was obviously wrong. She broke up with someone she called a good friend because the other lady did not include her in an investment project. She uses people to get what she wants. She would call me and speak for a long time whenever she wants me to do something for her. She once asked me to pray for a lucrative business deal and promised to tithe from the profit. But after the deal was done, she didn't fulfill her promise. And other than that, I rarely hear from her. But here's the thing. This woman once said to me, "I don't suffer fools gladly." This is a very English phrase, okay? "I don't suffer fools gladly." Now, I have some idea what that means, but not sure how it works in her life. But as I got to know her better, I saw the arrogance and the haughtiness. She has no patience with people she considers stupid or less educated or less polished or even less ambitious than her outwardly. Sad to say, she has lost all her friends because no one can correct her or are good enough for her. Jesus says we must start by learning how to judge ourselves. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, the Lord says, For the time has come for judgment, and it must begin with God's household. God's judgment is around, is happening, but it begins with the church, with God's own family. And God wants us to do this on a regular basis. And we need to practice judging ourselves regularly. And God has provided a means by which we do it. Okay, read together 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 28 to 30. The Word of God says, "This is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and some have even died." Now, for the older Christians, you know where this is set. Okay, this scripture is set in the context of the Lord's Supper or Holy Communion. Now, communion is the outward, when we have communion, we are experiencing the outward expression of God's inward grace working in our life. And we are commemorating and celebrating the death of our Lord Jesus on the cross and appropriating by faith all the benefits that come from His sacrifice, like forgiveness and healing. However, this passage tells us very clearly, this grace includes a warning. I am to examine and judge myself to see if I have dishonored the body of Christ. And this means, in its widest context, if I have said or done anything to damage the Lord's family. You know, that's why it's dangerous to believe in the teaching that says you don't have to confess or repent of your present sins after coming to Jesus. And so the more times you take communion, the more you should examine yourself. And often, when we evaluate someone or judge a situation, we often say we do it out of love or care for the people involved. And we would claim that we are objective and fair. In fact, when we're doing it, we're quite strict with other people. And so Jesus says in Matthew chapter 7, verse 2, "For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged." So, what are the locks in your eyes? If you cannot tell, will you humble yourself to allow someone else to show you? Let he or she be your tutor, your examiner, so that you can obtain a distinction in the art of judging 101. That's level one of the art of judging. Judging myself. The second level of judging has to do with judging the fruit or the fruits. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 15 to 23, Jesus says, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" Here is a clear instruction from the Lord Jesus Christ that we must judge, and judge rightly. While the first level of judging is about myself, this second level, this second aspect of judging is about other people, another person, especially people who claim to be prophets, and by implication, spiritual leaders of one form or another. He says we must look for their fruit and examine what that fruit or fruits are like. Fruit in the Bible has one meaning, one clear meaning. It's a figure of speech for one thing only. It has to do with character. The Bible has a strong and uncompromising emphasis on character and ethics. There is a whole section in the Bible talking about the fruit of the Holy Spirit, which we have talked about here. There's another whole chapter on the subject of love. Verse after verse, God stressed the need to develop Christ-like character in all who claim to know Him. You see, character and ethics are connected, integrally connected to justice. And Jesus is saying here that people are easily swayed by outward forms and hyped up proclamations. You know, people are awed by big titles and positions. Many people are impressed by numbers. Have you heard people say, "His church is so big, how can he be wrong?" Now, don't misunderstand, okay? Big numbers can indicate good things that are happening. But don't forget, other religions and sects and cults have big followings too. And I can tell you this, I used to have a big church, but I was also wrong in quite a few things. We are interested in our reputation, but God is more concerned about our character. And Jesus said that on the day of judgment, He will reject some people who may even claim to have done miraculous works in His name. And He gave two reasons for His judgment. Firstly, He called them ravenous wolves disguised as innocent, harmless sheep. And the word ravenous is described as, in the Greek, it's called harpax. And the definition is vicious, destructively ferocious, violently greedy. That is like a robber, a violent swindler. So this indicates that such people are greedy. They're greedy about money. They can be vicious. If they don't get their way, they can even harm you. And ultimately, they care little about people. They're interested primarily in fattening their own bank accounts. Years ago, there was a lady who came to church with a child. And in my conversation with her, she told me that she had left a very big church and was visiting us. And she gave me the reason that she left the church because she was called up to see the senior pastor in his office because she was found to be not tithing. So I asked her, why were you not tithing? Well, she explained that she had become a single parent, her husband had left her, and she could not even pay her bills. So she was like put on the carpet because of this. And she was very hurt by whatever went on. The pastor, she said, was more concerned about her tithes than her welfare. Now, the church she used to attend, she named to me, I know, has literally hundreds of millions of dollars in their reserves. This was reported in the media. And I know the pastor and his wife, and they were into first class about everything. Now, I believe and teach about tithing too. And I'm not against pastors having a comfortable income. And they should be well looked after if they're ministering to a lot of people and having sacrificed. But I also see that in the book of Acts, the church expended much of its resources taking care of the poor and needy. And there are times when people cannot tithe for reasons not of their own making. And to me, it's troubling to see church leaders having indulgent lifestyles while some of their members, some of their flock, languish in poverty. The second reason for the Lord's judgment on these prophets and leaders is that they practice lawlessness. And the word practice comes from the Greek word agaizoma. Okay, agaizoma, which literally means work, perform, bring about, make happen. This word means that not only do these people live lawless lives, that is, they have no concern, they have no fear of God, but they also bring about and make happen lawlessness. Knowingly or unknowingly, they are befriending, encouraging, or even promoting lifestyles devoid of any reverence for God and others. For instance, you know, quite a few leaders of big ministries will never come out openly and say homosexuality is a sin. This aspect of judging has to do with what you support and what you are part of. Now, please understand, I'm not inciting suspicion or cynicism about leadership, because leadership is hard. But for every compromised pastor, there are hundreds of authentic shepherds who deserve your support and encouragement. However, I do believe that God wants us to be critical in a wise and healthy way so that we don't come under deception and pour our energy and resources into the wrong hands. So we need to learn how to judge the fruit. The third level of this course on the art of judging has to do with the spirit, judging the spirit. Now, by spirit, here I'm referring to the spirit in people or behind people. And there are two sides to this dimension. The first is what I call the prejudice or prejudice. Okay? This is a legal term. Okay? And Jesus talked about, when Jesus says do not judge, he's talking about an attitude that has summarily concluded their perspective of someone. It's a kind of a censorious, fault-finding, nitpicking mindset. Such people will always find something negative to nullify anything and everything positive about others. We see this in the religious leaders who opposed Jesus. They were so filled with pride, envy, and hatred for him that nothing that Jesus said or did was ever positive. Here's a classic case. Go to Matthew chapter 12, verses 22 to 24. Read together with me. Then a demon-possessed man who was blind and couldn't speak was brought to Jesus. He healed the man so that he could both speak and see. The crowd was amazed and asked, "Could it be that Jesus is the son of David, the Messiah?" But when the Pharisees heard about the miracle, they said, "No wonder he can cast out demons. He gets his power from Satan, the prince of demons." When the Pharisees were told that a blind and dumb man was healed by Jesus, they immediately attributed this amazing miracle to Satan. There was no investigation. They didn't talk to Jesus. They didn't talk to the man who was healed, nor anyone else who had witnessed the miracle. And you can bet they have never seen Satan heal a blind man. This is called the Pharisaical spirit. The Pharisee spirit, the Pharisaical spirit has already made up his mind about something or someone. And no matter what other evidence pops up or whatever another witness may say, the other person is already guilty. You think the worst about someone. You sum up or condemn a person based on a few things that you don't agree with in his life, and you then believe and agree with every bad thing spoken about this person and disregard anything positive. I have a dear friend who, what you might call a colorful person. She's loud in her voice and in her dressing. She colors her hair. She wears large, sparkling costume jewelry and shoes with blinky decorations. And as a result, she was sometimes deemed as unspiritual or attention-seeking. One time, there was a disagreement over some matter in a ministry that she was part of. And one leader in the team would listen to one party and without listening to my friend at all, concluded that that party was right while my friend was wrong. And as a result, she was forced out of that ministry. Now, I happen to know all the people who were involved there. My friend actually is one of the most compassionate and committed prayer counselors I know. God has used her to bring deliverance and healing to hundreds of people. She now trains and leads many others in the ministry with an international standing. So, this is the Pharisaical spirit. Okay? We need to be aware of that in ourselves, and then we can see it around us. See behind some decision or action. Think the worst about someone, sum up or even condemn a person based on a few bad things in his life, and then we begin to believe and agree with every bad thing spoken about this person and disregard anything positive. The other side of this judging the spirit has to do with what I call the discernment of spirits. And this is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10. Okay, read with me. It says there, "To another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits." So that passage of the Bible is talking about the power and the work of the Holy Spirit. And this is one of those manifestations of the Spirit. It has primarily got to do with casting out evil spirits from people who are demonized. But it also includes an ability to see what is behind personalities, activities, and movements. For instance, over the years, the Holy Spirit has empowered His servants to discern the spirit behind Freemasonry and the LGBTQ activism movement. Now, this is not the place to talk about Freemasonry, but I can tell you what the spirits behind homosexual activism are. They are rejection, deception, and lawlessness in progression. Because of time, I cannot elaborate. The eventual outcome of full-blown LGBTQ acceptance is anything goes in society. It's called lawlessness. When good becomes evil and evil becomes good. The world is bad enough as it is. This will really cause huge problems in the spiritual life of the nation. As we learn to judge rightly, we need to add in something called mercy. In Psalm 89, verse 14, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face. Psalm 101, verse 1, I will sing of mercy and justice. To you, O Lord, I will sing praises. And then James chapter 2, verse 13, there will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when He judges you. God knows the truth. He knows even the worst things about us, but yet still loves us just the same. He gives us time to repent and change. That's mercy. It's part of what we call unconditional love. But remember, unconditional love is not unconditional approval. God loves the sinner, but He hates the sins. Actually, it's not difficult to love a sinner and hate his sin. You know why? Because we do this with ourselves. Now, there are many things I don't like about myself. I even hate some of the things in me, but I still love myself. So loving someone does not mean that I have to also agree or endorse or approve of their vices or agree with their sinful behavior. Truth and mercy go together. And ultimately, God's judgment is redemptive, not destructive. So that must also be our understanding and the exercising of judgment in our lives. One last point. We must know when to pause or to stop judging. In Matthew chapter 7 and verse 6, the Lord Jesus says, don't waste what is holy on people who are unholy. Don't throw your pearls to pigs. They will trample the pearls and then turn and attack you. You can discern the spirit of a person who is unwilling, is unteachable, or doesn't want to receive from you. So Jesus says, don't fret when you detect that. Now relax, pause, stop. Ultimately, it's their life. You cannot change others. You can only change yourself. And if you persist, the person will react and maybe even attack you. Have you encountered people like that? Their favorite defense is actually attack. The moment they feel any prick of criticism, the hackles go up and they start criticizing you in return. And Christian parents and spouses trying hard to share Christ with their loved ones know and have often experienced this when we try too hard. So we need to understand there's a time that may come for us to hold back or even withdraw for a while. Let's review our course notes on the art of judging, okay? Level 1, judge self. We must be clear-headed and deal with self first, according to the Word of God. We put ourselves under the authority of God's Word. And where we find any aspect of our life not in alignment with what God says, we accept the correction, especially if somebody points it out to us. Second level is to judge the fruit that we see around us. Okay, don't get dazzled by the hype or by the likes or by the sounds. Judge the fruit. Good trees produce good fruit. Bad trees produce bad fruits. Then thirdly, judge or discern the spirit behind what is going on. Ask God to give you that discernment, that revelation. And then finally, go with mercy, because we need mercy. And lastly, know when to pause or to stop. May the Lord add to us His grace, His wisdom, and His power, so that as we are being trained by Him, we will come out with that distinction to be able to judge and rule with Him in the days to come. In Jesus' name, let us pray together now. So, Father, we thank You for Your lesson. Thank You for the critical faculty You've given to us. And Lord, we want to first of all dedicate it to You. So let's dedicate our intellect. Let's dedicate our ability to think, to analyze things to the Lord. And we want, Lord, this faculty of our brain, our personality, to be infused with Your truth, Your word of Your grace and Your revelation, so that we will always be able to discern and judge wisely and correctly, with mercy, with grace. Lord, thank You. Thank You, Lord, for this great future You have for all of us, that one day, even as we are being groomed by You right now, we will sit at the right hand of our Lord Jesus Christ and rule and judge. Hallelujah. Prepare us. Train me, Lord, even as I go through difficult circumstances. Help me to work out what is right and what is wrong, what Your word has to say, what Your character is involved in the situation that I'm going through, so that I can receive from You, hallelujah, a deeper and a greater capacity to understand and to represent You, hallelujah, in all the situations. Lord, we also pray for the churches that may be going through difficulties, people are going through the relationship difficulties, that You will raise up wise people, competent, mature men and women who will be able to have the influence to settle things, so that Your name will not be dishonored. There will be no shame brought upon Your church, O God. So we come to You. We need Your grace. We need Your protection. We need Your instruction. We need Your molding. Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord. We willingly accept that the judgment must begin first with the household of God. First with myself, before I think about judging other people. Thank You, Lord. In Jesus' name, we all say, Amen. Well, I trust that this whole series on justice and this final session about learning how to judge has encouraged you and given you some tools of how to go forward as a person who wants to shine for the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, the Lord needs wise people in this world. He's put us here for a wonderful purpose, to be able to influence through our demeanor, through our kind words, through our judgment about things in life, to be able to speak from a perspective that's divine, that's from the kingdom of God. I hope that people will see, wow, I always pray for young people that God will so use them that when they are in conversation with their friends or even with their parents and or in the places of work, they will come forth far wiser than their age. You can have a wisdom beyond your years. And even though I may be considered elderly now, I can still have wisdom beyond my years, because not everybody who is elderly have wisdom. Wisdom comes from God. And through His Word, as through prayer, through fellowship with Him and one another, and we can receive God's wisdom. So I also want to encourage you to take this teaching back to your cell groups. And for those of you who are not in cell groups, I want to encourage you to join us. And we will connect you with some group, and then you can come in on the Zoom evenings that are convenient for you. And talk about how we can apply God's truth in our daily lives. So thank you once again for being with us. We do appreciate your presence as well as your support. Okay, let's sing together the blessing song as we wind up today's service in Jesus' name.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you. The Lord bless you. To shine upon you and be gracious unto you, and be gracious unto you. Lord, lift up His countenance on you and give you peace. And be gracious unto you, and be gracious unto you.